jump through the ages. The cross of Christ for all to see, has brought us hope and victory. Trials that may come, your cross is hope I will hold on. In the shadows of my life, through the trials that may come.
Welcome to Clevedon Baptist Church. Great to see you. It's Stir Up Sunday. We'll explain more about that a little bit later on. We're also going to have the opportunity to celebrate the Lord's Supper together today. So if you're online with us, you may like to find some bread, some wine, so you can join with us as we seize these moments to remember and to proclaim Christ's death until he comes again. We're going to stand together and sing out and affirm our faith together. Our Father, everlasting, the all-creating one, God Almighty. Let's stand together.
Oh, our Father everlasting, the all-creating one, your God Almighty. And through your Holy Spirit, conceiving Christ the Son, Jesus our Savior. I believe in God our Father, I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit, our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. Defender, suffered and crucified, forgiveness is in you. Descended into darkness, you rose in glorious light, forever seated high. Oh, I believe in God our Father, I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit, our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. We believe, oh, I believe in you. Oh, I believe. Rose again. I believe that Jesus Christ is Lord. Oh, I believe in you. Oh, I believe you rose again. Eternal. I believe in life eternal. I believe in the virgin birth. I believe in the saints' communion and in your holy church. I believe in the resurrection when Jesus comes again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. For I believe in the name of Jesus, for we believe in the name of Jesus.
And so, Lord, we come in faith, believing in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Lord, we thank you that today we can remember and proclaim the death of our Lord Jesus until he comes again. Come, Spirit of God, and be at work in this place. And through those, in those who have gathered online with us. Lord, we gather in the name of Jesus together. Amen. Great. Please sit down. And when you came in, you should have been given an envelope. Obviously, if you're at home online, you haven't got one. I'm sorry about that. We couldn't pass one to you through. We haven't got that technology yet. John, if you'd like to put your pictures up on the screen, that would be great. I think we've just jumped on one there. Should we go back one? There you go. Stir Up Sunday. You need to find your envelope because Stir Up Sunday is when we kind of do the old Christmas pudding, stirring it up, making it today. You've got to do it today, apparently. Now, I don't mess around doing that these days. I go and get a Christmas pudding. And this Christmas pudding I got last year. This time last year. And the great news about this Christmas pudding is that it lasts till next year. Not long into next year, but nevertheless, January 2022. So we're still okay with this one. And this will be lovely, mature Christmas pudding now. And but the idea of Stir Up Sunday is you get all the ingredients out and you stir up. So in our envelopes, Joe, what have we got in our envelopes? You'd like to explain.
We've got a spoon.
Spoon. You need a spoon in your envelope. So it's Stir Up Sunday, you see. And what else do we need in here?
You need your tag.
You need a tag. It's in the envelope.
And you tie your bit of string onto your tag. There's a little hole.
Is there? There's a little punch hole. Now, we don't want to see all the dots around on the floor in here. It doesn't matter. That's all right.
So put your bit of string through the hole.
Okay, so you do that. You thread the string. Just like that. Is that okay?
Yeah.
And then we tie it.
You've got a sticker.
Sticker.
You could put that on the tag, might be easiest first.
Okay, then there's a sticker in the thing, which has got the prayer, which is that prayer, which we're going to use in a minute.
So the Stir Up Sunday prayer. Everybody got that far? So label onto the tag and piece of string on it, so it's a gift tag.
You see?
Just give everybody a few seconds.
Good stuff, well done.
And then you're going to tie that onto the top of the spoon.
Or anywhere on the spoon.
Top of the spoon. And then it will end up looking like that.
Oh, that's the top of the spoon. I see what you mean, yeah. Is that the bottom of the spoon or the top of the spoon?
You can put it wherever you want to put it.
Yeah, that's right.
But the one I did earlier is up the top. I call it the top.
Okay, great stuff.
How's everybody doing?
Okay, so it looks like that then. Great stuff. Now, we're going to use this prayer. Now, I don't want you lot stirring each other up. That's no good. Unless we're stirring up each other for good stuff. But what we do want to do is pray that God would be at work in our lives. And there's this great prayer. So as you're thinking about making your Christmas pudding, if only you could. No, some of you will be doing that, I know. You stir up. And you can take the spoon home and remind you that we're praying that God would stir us up and do stuff in our lives, that we would live as his faithful people out in the world. So the prayer's on your tag as well, but it's on the screen. Should we pray this prayer together? Let's do that. Say these words. Pray these words, more importantly, that this would happen in our lives. So we'll pray together.
Stir up, O Lord, the wills of your faithful people, that richly bearing the fruit of good works, they may by you be richly rewarded through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
And we pray that, Lord, stir us up, stir up our wills so we can be kingdom of God people. Well, while you're finishing your tags off, and take that home and, might better lead that strategic places, and people say, "What have you got a spoon on your desk for?" And you can explain it this week. And it's Stir Up Sunday, the week before, which is next week, first Sunday in Advent, countdown to Christmas. It's all happening, which reminds us about Destination Bethlehem.
Destination Bethlehem. You need to get your places booked for Saturday the 4th and Sunday the 5th of December. You can do that on Church Suite, via the office. We're going to have some boards out this morning if you're here. But to think about who you could bring along, friends, families, neighbours, for our interactive journey through the Christmas story.
And next week we'll be packing down this room and setting up and school's work happening. So really exciting time. And you should have your costumes and all that sort of stuff sorted out ready and learning your lines or working out how you can strategically place your lines and props so you can look at them if you need to or that kind of stuff. But we're really looking forward to welcoming schools and youngsters into the building and people from the community at the weekend. So, Destination Bethlehem. And now it's an exciting day tomorrow as well because we are launching tomorrow Poets Muse Chaplaincy. And we've got four people in the church here who have done some training and they're going to be chaplains in Poets Muse, which is a sort of retirement care home, which has a specialist aspect of care for those with dementia as well. And we've been invited, we have Poets Muse Community Church meeting this afternoon anyway, and that goes on week by week. But this is an addition into that, an invitation for us to have chaplains in there. And so we're going to do the presentation of the chaplaincy T-shirt. You're going to see the chaplains get hold of, show this T-shirt.
That's on the back.
That's on the back, says chaplaincy. Very, very smart chaplain. And our Poets Muse little logo there. So Andy is going to be one of our chaplains. Come and stand up here, Andy, and we will present you with your shirt. Karen is going to be one of our chaplains in Poets Muse. And come forward.
Shall I give them out?
Yeah, give them out.
There we are, Andy.
There you go,
there's
Andy.
Your Polish shirt.
And Karen, Susan. Come and get your chaplaincy T-shirt. We won't ask you to put them on now, but we know that we'll get a photograph at some point with them on.
And that's for Cheryl.
And Cheryl is going to be chaplain as well in there. So we'd love to pray for you three and Cheryl, four.
We're going to launch.
And I've got a T-shirt as well because we're going to be in there working. We've already been doing chaplaincy work. Susan's been doing some work in there. In fact, all of us have been in there doing some pastoral chaplaincy work. But we're officially launching tomorrow at 10:30, so pray for us tomorrow morning, and then during the week, each week, our chaplains will be in there connecting, not just with residents and their families, but also the staff that work in Poets Muse. So we want to pray, Holy Spirit, that you would freshly anoint Andy and Karen and Susan and Cheryl as they step out to serve you in this new area of mission and ministry as chaplains in Poets Muse. We thank you so much for the way that Poets Muse have opened up to your people, Lord, that we've been able to establish, plant a congregation into that community. And we pray for the churches it gathers this afternoon. But Lord, we pray for this new initiative for chaplains as they seek to be a listening ear and to bring words of peace and comfort and good news to residents there, their families there, and to staff members there. So, Lord, we pray for a great start tomorrow as we have that coffee morning, launch morning with residents and staff in Poets Muse. Lord, would you hear our prayers? And Lord, help us to back up these four chaplains in our praying in the days to come, in Jesus' name. Amen. Bless you, you three, and Cheryl, we'll look out for you and make sure you connect with them during the week to find out how it's going. We're going to move into some worship that will lead us into communion, but as we do that, we're going to hear some words that will lead us into communion, into worship, and we're going to pray together. And then as we begin to worship, it's great to have the children in with us this morning doing our Stir It Up Sunday Spoons and our young people in with us. During these songs, you can move out and move into the rest of your activities this morning. But let's hear God's word to us.
The Apostle Paul tells us, "For the tradition which I handed on to you came to me from the Lord himself, that on the night of his arrest, the Lord Jesus took bread, and after giving thanks to God, broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in memory of me.' In the same way, he took the cup after supper and said, 'This cup is the new covenant sealed by my blood. Whenever you drink it, do this in memory of me. For every time you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the death of the Lord until he comes. Lord, we come to your table trusting in your mercy and not in any goodness of our own. We are not worthy even to gather up the crumbs under your table, but it is your nature always to have mercy, and on that we depend. So feed us with the body and blood of Jesus Christ, your Son, that we may forever live in him and he in us. Amen.
Amen.
You don't stand with us.
Well, they're in the chaos, they're in the dark. The body of Jesus, broken for us. He is our healing, he is our healing. Beautiful freedom, mercy has won. You have redeemed us with your precious blood. You are salvation. You are salvation, one King so worthy. This is Jesus, the hope of glory. This is Jesus, there's no higher name. Yours is the anthem that never dies. You are the way and the truth and the life. You are our victory, Lord, you are our victory. One King so worthy. This is Jesus, the hope of glory. Jesus is no higher name. There is no higher name than Jesus. God living, God breathing, God walking, God God speaking, God weeping. This is Jesus, this is Jesus. Christ at play, Christ dying, Christ loving, Christ raising, Christ reigning, Christ shining. This is Jesus, this is Jesus. It is triumph, chains are broken, head is vanquished, heaven's open, hallelujah, all adore him. This is Jesus, this is Jesus, one King so worthy. This is Jesus, the hope of glory. This is Jesus, there's no higher name. There is no higher name than Jesus.
Yeah, we proclaim this morning, Jesus, there's no higher name than you. You're the God who is with us. Each of us, Jesus wants to speak to us. God is close.
And risen, crucified Saviour, Lord, we thank you for the great salvation that you accomplished, won for us. Lord, help us to remember In Jesus' name, amen. Please sit down. We invite all who know Christ as their Lord and Saviour to share in this meal. And so, whether we're here in the auditorium, you're joining us online, let's eat, let's drink with faith and thanksgiving. Take this bread and remember that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your heart by faith and with thanksgiving. And then let's drink wine. Drink this and remember that Christ's blood was shed for you. And let's be thankful. So let's eat and let's drink together. And as we're doing this, some pictures and words will come onto the screen as we remember and proclaim the death of Christ together.
You gave me mercy when I was lost. You took the worst in me, paid the great cost. My life was shattered, lost all that mattered. Broken and battered, left in the dust. As I look to the cross, I am changed. As I look to the cross, I am changed. If forgiven is all that I'm given, there's nothing more I need. If forgiven is all that I'm given,
forgiven is all that I've given.
as we share in this fellowship meal together. Lord, we pray for one another. And Lord, we pray for those who are part of our church family who are struggling with sickness, who are experiencing the frailty, the weakness of their bodies. And Lord, we pray for them. Lord, maybe some are joining us online right now. Lord, we want to pray for them. Pray for your well-being, your wholeness, your healing, your strength, your presence, your hope. And Lord, we thank you for that salvation hope that we have in you. And Lord, we pray that for one another, that as we press on into your kingdom purposes day by day, we may do that as your people, with faith, in unity together, praying for one another, encouraging one another, loving one another, supporting one another. Lord, we pray for our children, our young people, as they are this moment now, engaging with your word and exploring what the Bible will be saying to them as we're sharing good news with them. Lord, we pray for Destination Bethlehem as a church family here want to share with others the life-transforming message of Jesus. And so, Lord, your death, O Lord, we commemorate. Your resurrection, we confess. Your final coming, we await. Glory be to you, O Christ. For Christ has died, and Christ is risen, and Christ will come again. Amen. Shall we stand together? We're going to sing, Thine Be the Glory.
The victory, thou art.
Please sit down. And we're going to turn in our Bibles to Daniel chapter 12 and the last verse, actually, of Daniel chapter 12. And we're looking at the road ahead. And in Daniel chapter 7 through to chapter 12, we have this big picture stuff with apocalyptic prophetic visions. It's breathtaking stuff. It's disturbing. It has a high impact, certainly upon Daniel. It's hope reassuring, prophetically equipping, faith building, exhilarating stuff for Daniel and for God's people. Visions, remember back in Daniel 7, days of war and hardship. And we become aware through these visions of the horror, the consequences, the outworking of human wickedness and evil and fallenness and the brokenness and the misery it produces, the outworking of human decisions, free will choices, human actions on the earth, things we can see. And it doesn't make for good viewing. And also, we've noticed over these weeks, Daniel 7 through to 12, that we get this insight kind of behind the scenes, in the heavenly realms, things we can't see, of angels and fallen angels, of spiritual forces in battle, of fallen angels, of demonic powers at work, of the spiritual warfare that is taking place. And then we've got this insight of how rulers and powers and nations and empires and structures and systems, they will rise up like beasts. And we read of powers and rulers and nations who rebel against God, not just turn from God, but in fallen, willful arrogance, turn against God and turn against his people. And so God's people find themselves under pressure, pushed into exile, under persecution, under severe attack, as there are those who come and seek to shut down the very people of God, to shut down their worship, to do, in fact, away with God's people. It's all there in Daniel 7 through to Daniel chapter 12. And as we've noticed, for Daniel, he's kind of looking forward. It's all future. For us, we can look both ways. We can look back and see some of what Daniel is seeing already fulfilled in history. In fact, somebody's worked out there are 135 predictions that speak of the next sort of 360-ish years ahead of Daniel, and that's all happened. You can read about it, you can see about Babylon and Persia and Alexander the Great and Greece and Antiochus as he comes, persecutes, oppresses, tries to obliterate the people of God. But with Daniel, we also look forward. It gives us prophetic realism that explains history and the story, the drama that's happening around us, before us in these days. And with Daniel, we look ahead because this Daniel stuff, even prophetic prophecy fulfilled, becomes a kind of model, a paradigm, a foreshadowing of what is to be. Of nations rising and falling, of wars and rumors of wars, of battles, of hardship, and the final battle, a time of anguish greater than any since nations first came into existence. But that's not all. Within all that we see, that there is hope, hope springing forward. For God is sovereign, for God is victorious, for God will limit enemy action and intrusion, for history will be according to his book. For God acts and will act in history, that God rescues and delivers his people. For Daniel speaks of deliverance, acts of salvation, acts of rescue. And as we come into the final part in chapter 12, Daniel speaks of resurrection. Resurrection to everlasting life, or to shame and everlasting disgrace, which the New Testament will call hell. Resurrection, everlasting life. And if the wise and the righteous are pictured as shining as bright as the sky and shining like stars. And then we come to the end. And we have the ending, and then there's two endings. We have the ending of this Old Testament book and the ending which speaks of two endings. As we come to the end of Daniel, all of a sudden it becomes personal. Deeply personal. God's words that become directional and motivational, insightful for Daniel. God says, as for you, Daniel, kind of get this contrast. We've had all this big vision stuff of the future and what's going on, things seen, things unseen. And now, all of a sudden, it's as for you, Daniel. Words to build resilience and assurance and hope and well-being in what for Daniel were challenging, high pressure, dangerous, chaotic days. Very much like our days. The ending has a focus on Daniel. It's God's word to Daniel, as for you. We need that divine, personal, God relational reality into our whole life discipleship and spirituality. As for you. You. You're thinking, no, you mean the person next to me or in front of me? No, as for you. There needs to be. Hey, there can be. And as for you, into your life in these days. As for you, go your way until the end. You will rest, and then at the end of the days, you will rise again to receive the inheritance set aside for you. And you'll notice there's two endings. There's an ending for Daniel until the end, his end, until his life comes to an end. Look, he's well on in years by now. Still living for God in those senior years of his life. But those years will come to an end because life at its longest is still too short. So a headline, alerted to it, good news headline, Britain's to live 8 years longer. As I delved into this great news, we, United Kingdom, we're going to be top of the lifespan league. Hey, this is good news, I thought. And as I read down, you have to go to the small print on this stuff, don't you? And as you read down, but, oh no, there's a but in here, it won't be until 2062. So you do the maths. And then, men, 87.3, women, 90.3 years, but still then, even if we're top of the league, in lifespan, life at its longest is still too short. Oh, Calvin Klein, they offer eternity for men and women. Little Christmas gift you could think about if you're stuck. both perfume and aftershave, but it soon runs out. Even if you go for the really expensive 100 mils bottle, not giving anything away here. And they're even talking about discontinuing it anyway. They're going to do away with eternity. We need the type of eternity, the eternal life, which Christ alone brings to us. Why? Because life, at its very longest, is still too short. And then we have this reference again to the end, not just of Daniel's time on earth, but to the end of the days. And so here are words to Daniel about responsibility, about rest and resurrection. And you? Go about your business, how one translation puts it, without fretting or worrying. Go your way until the end. It is not to become stuck. He is to go. He is to go. Daniel, you need to go. And for Daniel, your way meant the God way. To go and continue in the journey of being, phrase that we borrow from the New Testament, the people of the way. God's way. Until the end. So stir up your will, Daniel. I mean, he'd have been well pleased with his spoon and tack if he'd have been around on Stir Up Sunday, just in case you're wondering, they didn't do it then. But do it until the end, your own ending, which, as we will see, is not the end at all anyway. Daniel, don't make the mistake of staying and trying to merge with the surrounding culture and therefore trying to hide away, as some were doing. Or don't make the mistake and withdraw from the world around you and hide away. You're to go. Go about your business. Get back Daniel on your front line. He's to get on with it. He's to go. In New Testament speak, to be salt and light in a decaying and dark world. Just as we are sent by Jesus back into the world around us. Not to merge with it, not to hide from it, but to be salt and light in it. He could commit to doing what he's seen in his vision, to live out wisdom and righteousness. Those who are wise will shine as bright as the sky. Those who lead many to righteousness will shine like the stars forever. Or as the Apostle Paul puts it, carry the light-giving message into the night. Philippians 2, continue to work out your salvation with fear and trembling, for it is God who works in you to will and to act in order to fulfill his good purpose. Do everything without grumbling or arguing, so that you may become blameless and pure, children of God without fault in a warped and crooked generation. Then you will shine among them like stars. You get the picture? The night sky, like stars in the sky, as you hold firmly to the word of life. The famous novelist Robert Louis Stevenson, as a child, the story goes, he stood transfixed at his bedroom window watching a lamplighter moving along the street. And for us here, lamplighting, after we'd done Destination Bethlehem for 560 times, we'd be well used to what lamplighting is all about. Apparently his nanny asked him what the man in the street was doing. He said, I'm watching the man knocking holes in the darkness. Hey, look, Daniel, look, church, here in 2021, go back, go back, go to your front lines, go into your 104 hours of sent mission, go and knock holes in the darkness. You will rest. As for you, go your way until the end. You will rest. You want some rest? And then at the end of days, you will rise again to receive the inheritance set aside for you. The promise of rest and resurrection. Rest and resurrection living, free from the burden of fallen weariness and the fear of the grave, into the human restlessness. The God promise of rest. So the psalmist says, truly my soul, it finds rest in God. That's where it finds rest. Rest in God. My salvation comes from him. Yes, my soul finds rest in God. Yes, yes, in God. My soul finds rest. My hope comes from him. And in a fallen, chaotic, scary COVID world, we are desperate for the promise of Jesus. I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live even though they die. Daniel, you will rise again. You will rise again to receive the inheritance set aside for you. Daniel, chapter 12. If you look back a few verses, you'll see it there. He's seen in his vision resurrection and everlasting life. We see an empty tomb. One of the houses we lived in the back garden was one of these, it's sort of like an ornamental big lump of rock, stone, had been left there by the people who had been in the house before. And someone in our house had the idea that that looked really good at the front of the house. Rather, I thought it looked good where it was. But the challenge was on to get this big lump of rock from the back to the front. And It's heavy. You couldn't lift the thing. Not enough to get it round to the front. So I put it off for days. And I was in the shed one day, and I found one of our youngsters, our children. They had skateboards, and they had the skateboard moment in life. And I found the old skateboard. And I came out of the shed with the skateboard, and Joe says to me, "You're not going out on that, are you? You'll do yourself an injury. You're banned from skateboarding." I could never do the thing anyway. I said, "No, I'm going to move that rock for you. No, you had the idea of moving it from the back to the front." And so I sort of got a shovel under this rock and got the skateboard under the rock, and it worked. I've still got the skateboard. I've moved fridges and washing machines, all sorts of stuff with this skateboard. Don't need some trolley thing. The skateboard has done its job well. And so I got it round to the front, and I put it there, and you know, the inevitable words came. I think I preferred it round the back, So as they go to the tomb, the women ask the question, "How are we going to roll the stone away from the entrance? This big lump of rock over the entrance of the tomb." They're taking burial spices to the tomb to put on the crucified body, buried body of Jesus. But they've got a problem. Who's going to move this big lump of rock? "Hey, I've got an idea. I've got a skateboard around there." When they get there, It's moved. That stone that had been the barrier, because that's what we do with death. We like to distance ourselves from the reality of death, so we kind of seal up death. We hide it away for a while. We block it out. But in the end, we will find ourselves the wrong side of the stone ourselves. But for now, we'll put the stone across. Yet the stone is rolled away, and we can look in, and we can see that the tomb is empty, because Christianity is always, always, always about the empty tomb of the risen, crucified Jesus. Daniel, you will rise. How can that be? People of God, we will rise and we will have new resurrection bodies. How can that be? Because the stone is rolled away and the tomb is empty. And the crucified, buried Jesus is risen again. The stone was rolled away. His perfect love could not be overcome. Now, death, where is your sting? Our resurrected King has rendered you defeated. Forever he is glorified. Forever he is lifted high. Forever he is risen. He is alive. The road ahead, here it is. Not just for Daniel, but for all of us here and watching. As for you, go your way until the end. You will rest. And then at the end of the days, you will rise again to receive the inheritance set aside for you. Stand together.
Stars they went, morning sun was dead, the Savior of the world was fallen, his body on the cross, his blood poured out for us, the weight of every curse upon him.
He is alive.
has overcome. It's now death, where is your sting? Our resurrected King has overcome. He's overcome.
Truly my soul finds rest in God. My salvation comes from him. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live even though they die. You will rise again to receive the inheritance set aside for you. Lord, drive your word home deep into our souls, our lives this day. We declare as your people that Christ has died, that Christ is risen, that Christ will come again. Lord, we thank you that the stone is rolled away. And we look in. The tomb is empty. But he is the risen one, that he is alive. And so, Lord, as we see the road ahead, we hear those words of commission afresh, that as your people, we are to go into God's world. Let's go and shine like stars. And let's go with joy and peace and love and hope in our hearts. And may the blessing of Almighty God, Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer be with you all. In Jesus' name. Amen.